So my name is Jason Fleming. I'm a professor of surgical oncology at MD Anderson Cancer Center.
And I'm Eugene Koay. I'm a senior resident in radiation oncology at MD Anderson Cancer Center and a postdoc at the Houston Methodist Research Institute.
So our research group focuses on pancreatic cancer. It's still an unsolved clinical dilemma with it being the fourth leading cause of cancer death in the United States. There's limited effective therapy. The reason for that is complex, but one of the principal postulated reasons is that the tumors are very dense in their makeup, with a very dense connective tissue or scar around the tumor cells. The animal studies have suggested that this is a principal limitation for delivery of any kind of chemotherapy into the tumor, and therefore limits its effectiveness. So the purpose here was to investigate whether we identified that in humans, and also to see if there are any clinical correlates that would help us measure that in the course of patient treatment.
We conducted an interdisciplinary study involving physicians, basic scientists, engineers, and mathematicians from multiple institutions. And our objective, as Dr. Fleming mentioned, is to understand the delivery of or transport of gemcitabine to pancreatic cancer cells in humans. And to describe the drug delivery process, we developed a way to quantify the transport properties of individual human tumors from routine CT scans and correlated these transport properties with drug delivery in a novel clinical trial. So the CT analysis involved taking direct measurements of the changes in density due to the intravasation and extravasation of iodine contrast during routine CT scans. We developed a new mathematical model to describe the changes in density as a function of time. Using this method, we derived multiple transport properties such as an initial intravasation rate, a maximum enhancement, and an area under the enhancement curve, or AUC for abbreviation. As an example, two patients with adenocarcinoma in the head of the pancreas are depicted in this slide. Patient one has a tumor that does not enhance much relative to the normal pancreas, and you can see that in the CT scans on the left, as well as in the measurements on the right. The mathematical model captures this behavior and is shown in the red and blue lines for tumor and normal pancreas, respectively. Patient two, on the other hand, has a tumor that enhances very similarly to the normal pancreas, and this is also captured in the measurements and the mathematical model. We conducted several studies to show that the mathematical model was robust. While we developed this mathematical model and the CT analysis method, we also conducted a novel clinical trial where we infused gemcitabine during the curative resection of patients with pancreatic cancer. The concept for the trial is shown here in the figure. For each patient, we immediately sampled the tumor and the normal pancreas so that we could quantify gemcitabine DNA incorporation. Despite well-controlled infusion conditions in the operating room, we saw marked variability in the gemcitabine incorporation in the 12 patients that were recruited to the trial. And this ranged from about 135% more delivery in the tumor relative to the normal pancreas for the patient on the left side of the graph, down to 75% less delivery in the tumor relative to the normal pancreas for the patient on the right side of the graph. And we saw everything in between that. When we scored the HENT1 staining in the tumor samples as either high or low, we found significant differences in gemcitabine incorporation. Furthermore, we found a significant inverse correlation between the amount of stroma in the tumors and the gemcitabine incorporation, but this correlation was only seen when the HENT1 was accounted for. So essentially, more stroma meant less gemcitabine delivery, but when you have low HENT1, this inverse correlation relationship was shifted downward, as one might expect. We also saw a direct correlation between the amount of stroma and the CT-derived transport properties. And just as stroma had an inverse relationship between the gemcitabine delivery, so did the CT-derived property AUC. We extended this correlation between CT-derived transport properties and drug delivery to clinical outcomes. We hypothesized that the variable transport properties could describe the variable pathological response to an outcome after gemcitabine-based chemoradiation for patients with resectable pancreatic cancer. Two cases are shown here in the slide of patients who received the same preoperative therapy but had very different pathological responses and also very different pre-therapy transport properties from their CT scans. When we analyzed 110 patients who were treated with gemcitabine-based chemoradiation on two phase two protocols, we found that the pre-therapy CT-derived transport properties correlated with the pathological response to therapy and the overall survival of the patients shown in this graph.
There's two principal findings from the study. The first is that the delivery of gemcitabine to the tumors was much more variable than would be predicted by the previous animal studies. The main influences that we identified for this were the amount of stroma or collagen density within the tumors and the expression of the HINT1 gateway molecule for gemcitabine incorporation into cells. Both of these make empiric sense, but point to the extreme variability of delivery that was heretofore unknown. The second main point is that the pre-treatment imaging and the pre-study imaging of those patients who received gemcitabine very accurately predicted which patients would be those who had efficient delivery of gemcitabine and which were those who had very poor delivery of gemcitabine when given intravenously. So, in short, the contrast, the intravenous contrast that's given during a CT scan examination of those tumors acted as a surrogate for the gemcitabine that was then given later. This is supported by other clinical data that's included in the manuscript, which demonstrates that this mathematical modeling that was developed for this study very accurately predicts which patients might be those who receive the most benefit from undergoing preoperative therapy, chemotherapy, or radiation. So the clinical relevance of this, we think, is very high. The principal reason is that these images that we used were the same images that were used in the course of therapy for all of these patients. These were not special studies that were performed there, which implies that this could be carried out in the routine care of patients and therefore predict which patients would benefit most from these types of therapies and which patients for which it may not be that helpful.